Hi everyone, this is Lahir from ABCs of Anesthesia. I'm really excited to do this video on IV cannulation 10 years after my very first video. So back in 2012, I did an IV cannulation video and you know that's the first video I ever made. It took me for ages to actually post up on YouTube. I think 2020 was when I posted that first video. Now I thought I'd redo that video and try to make a lot of improvements because a lot of things and knowledge have advanced since then, especially with aseptic non-touch technique, as well as just limiting the use of all the consumables to be a bit more environmentally conscious. So let's get started. So we're going to go through quite a number of things in this video. I'm going to try and replicate a lot of the steps in the old video because in that video, a lot of the good stuff still holds. Like a lot of it's still really useful and the technique is essentially the same. Today, we're going to go through the indication for IV cannulation, everything you need for a good setup, choosing a vein, as well as making that vein nice and large, as well as the insertion techniques. So everything from how to hold the hand or hold the skin and tether the skin correctly to holding the cannula, the insertion techniques, and then all the things you need to make sure that it's dressed well. And also going to go through a bit of aseptic non-touch technique because again, that's really important. Now, so one of the first things you want to do is clarify the indication. IV cannulation is probably one of the first things junior doctors and nurses and other health professionals learn, but it is still an invasive procedure. So I don't take that lightly. If I'm asked to do a cannula, I'd always say, you know, find out what the indication is. Maybe it's for fluids or for antibiotics or medications that could actually be given orally. So always clarify the route that can be given, and if it can be given orally or by another means, absolutely think about that as an option. You know, cannulation has its risks. There's always the risks of, you know, bleeding and a hematoma, as well as getting the wrong structures like tendons, muscle, nerves even. And then you always got those infection risks in the long term. It isn't without harm. So if you can find another way of giving that medication or fluid, always think about that as well. In some of my other videos, I go through a lot of detail on how to choose a vein, but essentially most of the time, you're going to be asked to choose a vein on the arm. So we'll go through a bit of that. Before I touch a patient, I always think about the 5 moments of hand hygiene by the WHO. So before I touch the patient or interact with the patient, I always perform hand hygiene. Now most of the time, I'd put on my gloves at this point. And generally speaking, I use non-latex gloves just to make sure that my patients don't have any reactions because latex allergy is pretty common. So now the first thing I do is put on a tourniquet, and I do this even before setting up my equipment. Now this tourniquet I generally put on the arm and not the forearm. That way I've got exposure completely all the way up and down from the arm to forearm as well as the hand. Now the tightness of this tourniquet, like it really is just a gentle pull. You know it's too tight because simply the patient will be complaining that it's too tight or the fact that you may not feel an arterial pulse. Just remember, this is a venous tourniquet. You just need it above venous pressure and not above arterial pressure. It means that if you really want to make sure that you're getting absolutely the perfect amount of pressure, you can use a blood pressure cuff. If you use a blood pressure cuff, that means that you can inflate it to just below arterial pressure or arterial diastolic pressure, and that way you make sure you get the maximum arterial inflow and limit venous backflow. And one of the other things you might see is someone putting a tourniquet in the forearm, and that's completely fine. Like, you know, you can be absolutely successful doing this. Just know that if you do that, a patient with good veins, it'll be no problem. But there is a potential that because there's 2 bones in the forearm, the radial and the ulnar, there's some veins that will traverse in between those bones, and these veins might be uncompressible. So it's kind of important to know that I still may have some venous backflow, which is not what I want. Therefore, for most cases, I put the tourniquet up around the arm. Now I'll go through some of the things to make veins stand out. Now the first thing is just to know your environment. Now hospitals are almost universally really cold environments. The air conditioning blowing in this theater, for example, is really quite cold. And so what you want to do is keep your patient warm. If your patient is cold, they will naturally venoconstrict so that they'll have all their veins constricting and it'll be very difficult to see the veins. Whereas if the patient is warm, the veins will vasodilate because that's just one of the mechanisms that the body uses to get rid of heat. So almost always I'll have the patient with a blanket on. Hopefully I can, you know, have a room that's warm, especially if it's on the wards. And sometimes warm towels are really useful as well. Now, one thing I don't do is use a warm, wet towel. So hot water on a towel isn't that useful, I find, because the water gets cold very quickly. And then as it's evaporating, it creates an even cooler environment. Now, one of the other steps in making your veins stand out is making sure that the vein in question is below the level of the heart. So really, you're using the hydrostatic pressure gradient and gravity to make sure that the veins are popping up. So you can see that these veins are quite prominent, but as soon as I raise it up, you'll see that they just aren't the same even with the tonic on, whereas down below, suddenly it increases a lot. Now, my mate here has particularly good veins. The other thing you can do is tap the veins like so, and that just increases the number of vasodilatory mediators in that vessel, and that allows the vein to pop up even more. So I just gently tap again. Some patients feel a lot of discomfort from this, in which case I just rub, but a few gentle taps are usually really fine and well tolerated by the patient. Now, really interesting fact that my mate has just told me, in the statue of David, the statue has one arm down and one arm up. It's really interesting to note that the arm that's down has veins that are prominent and visible, but the arm that is up at the face doesn't have veins that are prominent and visible. So even at that point in time, he was so observant about the hydrostatic pressure gradient and how that can affect, you know, your veins and the way they stand out. So thanks for a really interesting fact there. So I think there's a lot of fantastic resources out there that show really good aseptic non-touch technique. So I'm not going to go through a lot of that in detail, but just know that aseptic non-touch technique is a really great format for understanding how to keep your area and your patient contact and your procedures really clean and free from microbial contamination, which is really what you want to do. You're doing these invasive procedures. There's a lot of bugs in the surrounding structures, on yourself, as well as the surfaces and instruments that you're using potentially. And you want to make sure that those microorganisms aren't interacting or in contact with the patient. So that's what aseptic non-touch technique is all about. Now, there's two types of aseptic non-touch technique, broadly speaking, surgical and standard. And so in IV cannulation, all that's required is standard aseptic non-touch technique, which means that it's usually a short procedure that's technically not too difficult, and there's only a few key parts and key sites that you really need to be aware of. Now, key parts really refers to the fact that there's not too many parts to IV cannulation. The instruments I need are quite few, so there's the cannula, the IV bung, and the tegaden potentially. That's all that really stays on the patient, and the only invasive part is the IV cannula, so it has very few key parts, and I can avoid touching any part of that while I'm interacting with the patient and doing this insertion. Likewise with the patient, there's only really one key site, which is the IV in question and the point of cannulation. So the fact that there's very few key parts and key sites, and it's a short procedure and technically not too difficult, means that you're able to do this with standard aseptic non-touch technique. And because of this, I also use just non-sterile gloves. If I needed to touch parts of the cannula, which are meant to be sterile, I would then use sterile gloves. So that's why we're using standard technique. So let's talk about the equipment and the setup. Now, the great thing is there's not too much that you need to set up for IV cannulation. Now, I obviously need the IV cannula, and I'm just using a 22 gauge because I'm just demonstrating what the cannulation technique is like. There's a video for a 14 gauge cannula, as well as a few other interesting cannulations and difficult cannulas as well. So I'll put those in a link in a card just up above. I've got the IV bung, and this is used just to cap off the cannula, make sure that you don't get any fluid back. And it also provides a port with which I can inject fluids and medications as well. So that's the IV bung. I've got this tegaden film. So that's a trademark name by 3M. But essentially what I need is a dressing that's waterproof, but also breathable, that's adhesive and sticks nicely and covers everything and holds it in place. And ideally, I like something that's transparent, and that's what the tegaden is. I mean, there's a lot of different dressing options out there. Look, I've just used this one for many years. So essentially a breathable, waterproof adhesive dressing that is also transparent and clear. I make sure I have some kind of prep solution to disinfect the skin. So this is an alcoholic and chlorhexidine prep. Now just know that you've got to be really careful with chlorhexidine, because chlorhexidine is a relatively common allergic substance. So I always check with my patient if they have allergies before I put chlorhexidine anywhere near them. Now finally, once you place the cannula, you really want to make sure it's in. So I usually use a saline flush and a 10 mL syringe, and that way I can just flush the cannula to make sure that it's working well. So now when I do my setup, I first of all make sure I've done hand hygiene and I've donned some non-sterile gloves. And then I make sure that when I open each of these parts, I don't necessarily have to take it out of the cover. So I can open the tegaden just like so. I can open the cannula like that. And even though it has a cap, you can often just keep it in its plastic wrapper just like so. Same with the IV bung. You don't need to take it out of the wrapper. You can just hold it at the last minute and keep it kind of clean and have a micro-sterile feel there, is what they call it. I can use this when I need to use it. And I often take this out, open, and draw up the 10 mils of saline and have it capped. So again, that's sterile. It's not in contact with the outside world. I'll just put that there like so. So the other most important thing to have in my setup is a sharp spin. And so that way I'm making sure that as soon as I've done the cannulation, I place that sharp straight in the bin, and that way it minimizes the risk of sharp injuries to myself or anyone else in the vicinity. Let's get started with this cannulation attempt. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the tourniquet on, and again, just put it at the right level. Now, interestingly, when you first start out, you know, there's a lot of things that you're going to be keeping in mind. I think I outlined maybe 20 individual steps in cannulation. So it isn't the simplest procedure when you first start out. So now after I put the tourniquet, the next thing I do is I make sure that I put something underneath the arm just in case I get a bit of blood spilled. That way it doesn't drop onto the patient or onto the bed. And so the easiest thing to do is just put a towel down. And I put a towel instead of a bluey. Now the blueys, we realized that they're actually really hazardous to the environment. They also stay in landfill for over 100 years. So really, really bad for the environment. So that's why just using a towel is really easy to do for these purposes. So the next thing I do, I just start by prepping the skin. And so we've got a nice vein here, just across there. And after I've wiped it with the alcohol colloxidine, I try not to touch that again in the area that I'm going to cannulate, just to try and prevent any problems. Next thing I do, I hold the cannula like so, again making sure that my thumb and middle finger on either side, my pointer finger here, is free. That way I can see the chamber. This pointer finger is there to feed off the cannula as well. I then loosen the cannula, like I've shown in many of my other videos, and then I click it back into the place. I then tense the skin. So what that means is that I make sure that my finger isn't in the way of lowering the angle of my needle. It's always to the side. If I was cannulating somewhere more distal, I'd have it over the knuckles like that, so I can always get a low angle. I'm just going in over the site that I sterilized, in, and I'm looking at the chamber for flashback. I see flashback, I level out as you can see, and then I advance even further, a few millimeters, and then I thread off. You can see that my hand position hasn't changed at all. Next thing I do, I put my thumb proximally and feed the needle off. This needle goes straight to the sharp spin, that's disposed of, and then this hand goes over here to the tourniquet, and that eases the pressure there. Next thing I do is I take the IV bung. I'm used to taking this cap off with one hand, so I've got the IV bung there. Now note that I don't have a spare hand free to stabilize the cannula, and that's okay. I just jiggle it on like that, and that way it's absolutely fine. And then I transfer my hand. So all I did was have my thumb there, jiggle it on. Once it's pretty much on, then I can stabilize the cannula and make sure that this is nice and tight. I then take this cap off, ready to go. My very next step is to flush. I do this before I put the tegaderm on, just in case I need to withdraw the cannula a little bit or reposition it. So I just push it onto the end and just make sure that it flushes easily, which it is, which it absolutely is. I can also do a pulse test to make sure that that pulse is felt proximally, and it is. And there's no swelling that you can see, which is also a good sign. Very occasionally you might be able to aspirate, but that's not always a positive sign. Once I flush the saline, that can be disposed of as well. And finally, I put that transparent waterproof breathable dressing, so that tegaderm, I place that on, and that keeps the whole area sterile now. Now these are really great because they come with these little dated stickers, so I'll put that on here just to be able to label that later. I then label this, and I just put my initials as well. So that's cannulation done. Again, it's really important. I dispose of all my waste materials, and then I perform hand hygiene as I'm stepping away from the patient as well. Now it's really important to document and date when the cannula was put in, and also it needs to be checked every day. Sepsis due to line infections is a real problem in hospitals, so we make sure that we date and review the cannula on a daily basis. The cannula should only be for a maximum of 72 hours, so you really don't want to have it longer than that. And every day you need to be checking the cannula. For example, if there's any kind of redness, pus, or swelling there, if it's not flushing properly, then you really need to reassess and call someone for assistance, and potentially even need to take this cannula away, remove it, and then, you know, have someone have a look at the wound if there is a problem. So infection risk is a real problem. Maximum 72 hours. Make sure you document and review this cannula regularly. Now in my first video 10 years ago, I go through a couple of extra tips, including how to hold the cannula properly, as well as how to put tension on the skin properly, and how to avoid cutting the wrong surface of the vein. So let's go through a few of those tips now. So whenever I hold the cannula, I make sure that the cannula is the lowest structure of my hand. So it's not in this position, That way I can't get as low an angle as possible. I make sure that when I pick it up, my hand and my fingers are all above it. I hold it with the thumb and the little finger, as you can see, and that way I don't need to change my grip to feed off the cannula. Sometimes I see people holding it with a grip like this, which means that they have to change the tension in the skin to then feed off the cannula, which means that you lose that structure. You lose the structure and the tension on the skin, and that means that it's not going to be as accurate for the most difficult veins. So this is my technique for holding any cannula. In the most difficult veins, you want to make sure all your structures align. There's very minimal movement. That's why I use this grip. Now, when I put tension on the skin, I make sure that the thumb never gets in the way of my low angle. That low angle is absolutely vital to make sure that you're not cutting the wrong surface of the vein. Say I had a vein here, I wouldn't put my thumb there, I'd put it over the knuckle edge. That way, once I've got flashback, I lower down and I advance. If my thumb was there, if I got flashback, I just can't lower down enough and I'm at risk of puncturing the deep surface of the vein. Now, sometimes my vein will be on the forearm. So again, there isn't a knuckle edge to go below. So what I do is, instead of going there for a vein over here, I might put tension on the skin there. That way I get the needle through the skin, make a really low angle, then advance. This is similar with a cubital fossa vein. I don't put my thumb in the way. I make sure that's just to the side. As you can see, even at the cubital fossa, my thumb is out of the way. And that way, as I get the flashback, I can lower down really well. Something else you might have noticed is that when I'm about to cannulate, I rest my little finger and even the ring finger, and that gives me stability. If my hand was floating in the air, that means everyone has a little bit of a tremor, but this way I don't have a tremor, or I have much less tremor. You know, you can do that in any circumstance. Even if you're cannulating a hand vein, you may just rest your little finger on the hand, and that way again you've got increased stability. I use any surface for that stability. If I've got a vein around the back of the arm, I'd again anchor my fifth finger, my ring finger, and that just allows me to have more control and less tremor. When I was a sixth-year medical student, this is the one thing one of my interns taught me that just changed the way I cannulate, and I've gone through this in a few other videos which I can link to above, but just remember that this needle is an amazing design. So it's really, really great at cutting into the vein, but also really great at cutting through the other side of the vein. But fortunately, the bevel surface is really flat. So as soon as I get flashback, I flatten out and I aim for the top surface. And that way, there's just very little chance of cutting the top surface just because of the way this needle is designed. So that's my latest IV cannulation video. I've gone from start to finish, all the aspects of IV cannulation that I think you need to do a successful cannulation. I hope that was interesting for you. Really just wanna thank my helpers here. And yeah, if you like this video, please share with anyone who might be interested. And if you have any questions at all, please leave in the comments below. Thanks very much for watching and see you next time.